Yo, what's up everybody? Good morning, happy Saturday. What's going on? Got it all worked out, huh? What's up, Poison? How you doing? Nice. Yeah, the redemptions are working for you. That's solid. Good stuff, good stuff. It's good to see you, my friend. Good to see everybody. We got video gaming news for today, July 15th. And we're going to give Exo Primal another shot, dude. We're going to play it for another day, see how this goes. My early sentiments about the game are, you know, that it's pretty shallow, actually. It seems, unfortunately, coming out of Capcom, seems like more of a cash grab kind of game than anything. It seems like they have like something decent to build off of if they can figure out how to make it work. Oh, nice, Poison. That's great. That's great. Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. Cool. Cool. What was the issue? Was it just like some browser-based stuff or what? The game feels good, which, I mean, it's unfortunate to even have to say that about games, but honestly, especially on the AAA front of things, that's one of those things that we just have to, you know, unfortunately, often give kudos to developers, it seems, anymore whenever a game comes out and feels good. But we shouldn't have to, honestly. I mean, if a game gets released, a game should feel good, you know, and it feels bad that we even actually have to point out that, yo, a game got released and it's not a mess. That sucks, but that's the world we live in right now, and Capcom does a good job at game releases. They do. The game feels good, it plays well, but it's very shallow. It's very shallow, and it's just like you play the same mode over and over and over. And like, maybe there's some game mode stuff locked behind story progression, but people aren't playing this game for story. I think that what they needed to do is maybe separate that stuff into having a campaign mode and then just the core game modes of the game itself for anybody that wanted to dive into what the story had to offer. Instead of what I'm getting the impression that there might be more to the game as long as you keep progressing through the story. And I'm not playing this game for the story. I don't think a lot of other people are playing this game for the story, and it feels like a weird play from Capcom if that's the case. It feels real shallow right now. And it feels like a cash grab. It feels like they did very, very little on the creative thinking side for incorporating game modes for what people might want to be able to do and could possibly be able to do to have fun in this type of environment that they've created. And instead focused more on how they could make extra money. And the thing that's weird is that this is a full price AAA game. Unless you're playing it on a subscription service. And I'll say this. I think that everybody I don't think anybody should be paying full price for this game right now. I think that if you can at all possible play this on subscription service. It's on Game Pass, you know. And that's my take right now. Play it on Game Pass to get a taste of it. It's like a $60 or $70 game. And then it's just filled with microtransactions and battle pass, and it's really one of the it's so heavily saturated with that, the kinds of like in-game transaction stuff that you would expect it to be almost like a free-to-play game. It's what you would see out of a free-to-play game. And the fact that the game does feel so shallow is really, really, really a turnoff, man, for how they made this game cost this much out the gate. It's a bad play, in my opinion, from Capcom. But we're going to play it again today. We'll see if we unlock more progressing through the story, which you basically have to do playing the game mode. That's a weird thing. I don't know. But we'll see. We'll see how it goes, and we'll play it. What the game offers is fun. It's just shallow, and it gets old quick, man. Well, Dave's not done. We're going to be back to Dave, but I wanted to try this game. You know what I mean? Kayla, what's up, friendo? So Dave will be back. Look at those pupils, dude. Jesus. Yeah, Dave will be back. You know, Exoprimal was never something that I planned on being like a main or anything, but I wanted to try it. We've been following it for a long time, so it made sense to take at least part of the weekend here and give it a shot, you know? Sorry you missed Dave. The way it goes, though, we always eventually move on. So I hope everybody's doing well. They're always big first thing. Yeah, it's weird. Hope you guys are doing well. Let's go ahead and dive in here. We got video gaming news, and then we'll dive into the gameplay for Exoprimal for day two. Okay. First and foremost, we got what we're listening to this morning is BPM. It's a very, very good soundtrack from the game, Bullets Per Minute. It's a very good roguelike, first-person shooting, rhythm-based game. And it's got a really cool art style and stuff, too. It's an indie dev. So go check the game out, and highly recommend checking out the soundtrack. The soundtrack is really, really good. All right, let's get in here. That's not what I wanted to do. Fat clickings. There we go. Get in here and see what we got. The moving on I struggle with. Yeah, I know. I mean, there are certain games that for me, it's bittersweet as well, you know. I agree. There are certain titles for me where it just depends, you know, but there are definitely those titles where it feels bittersweet. It's like, I have had so much fun in certain games that it feels like Dave is going to be one of those games. There, I'll tell you this, for me, those games are few and far between. And Dave the Diver is one of those games where it'll be bittersweet to finish it up. And to kind of be done with it, because it has been so much fun, and it's been like a breath of fresh air, and I love playing it. So whenever we are finished with it, it'll kind of suck to be done, but it'll also be, you know, cool to see everything that the game had to offer, to be at the end of it, and to be ready to move on to something new, because you know that's how I am. Like I like to. I don't rush my games. I like to take my time and experience, you know, get real immersive with the games and stuff. But I'm always looking for that next gem, if you will, in the gaming world, you know, that next thing that feels like Dave the Diver. But they are few and far between, man. It doesn't happen to me very often where I'm like just this enamored by a game. So, you know, it's a tough thing. It's a tough thing. It is. The last one that got me tugging on my heartstrings, dude, was Stray. Stray did it to me. If you go watch the ending of Stray, you'll see. Yeah. Which we just played not too long ago. And the ending should be, it's not public on YouTube yet, but it's here on the Twitch channel. But that's the, it doesn't happen very often. Stray got me a little bit though. Yeah. Did some research on Oh, really? Oh, right on, Poison. Nice. Yeah. Oh, really? Yeah. See, I haven't played those games. I haven't played those games, Kayla. I watched like the first couple seasons of The Walking Dead, and then it just felt like I was watching the same exact thing over after that. It felt like it was just the same thing. It was the same thing being written in a different scenario all the time. And I was like, this is getting boring to me. And I just quit watching it. It just felt real repetitive to me as far as the show went. Yeah. Are they very different? Right on. I'll have to keep that in mind. So it's probably one of the reasons that I haven't really taken a look at diving into the game, you know. Poison, yesterday we looked at a new gameplay trailer for the Texas Chainsaw Massacre game coming out. It looked really cool. You might look into that. Let's see what else we got for the news here. Let's dive into these guys. We took a look at this yesterday. Yeah, lots of sales on Xbox's store right now. Team behind PlayStation's Patapon reveals successor game Ratatan. Take a look at that. We already talked about this too. Look, this is the parents' fault right here. That's all there is to it. We've already talked about this too. I'm a big proponent of video gaming history, man. And you know, this is a different, it's a different obstacle in this industry of entertainment than it has been for a lot of the other ones, like music or television or movies, to be able to maintain that history. You know, it's much different. There are a lot of different obstacles in how we can preserve it, and getting the developers on board to do it, which is why emulators have become such a big deal. And I'm a big proponent of emulators being used to preserve video gaming history. There are ways in which I'm not a proponent of emulators. I don't think they should be used to circumvent lifting up a healthy industry, and people should not be using them for piracy, as far as like, you know, emulating modern hardware and software. But I mean, they're a great thing for preserving video gaming history, man. No doubt about it. What up, Davey? Oh, that you can probably find that out, Kayla. Yeah, if you're interested in that, you know, if it does, the game doesn't quite tell you that, you can probably like do some research and find that out. Classic Call of Duty games revived by hundreds of thousands of players on Xbox. I wonder why. I wonder why. Yeah, you might be able, and even if it wasn't, even if you can't find anything explicit from the developers of the game, they probably did. They probably have something out there. There's probably a lot of fan theories out there too for the game that you can find as well. Yeah, but there's probably some legitimate backstory on where that all came from, you know. Just woke up, don't know what I feel like playing. That's a tough one, buddy. I know you've been heavy into the FF12, man. I know that. Fable 4's narrative lead is leaving Playground Games. I have not played The Last of Us either. No, I have not. I was really, really looking to play The Last of Us when it hit, because again, here's the thing, and I've told people this a lot. as somebody who's always played across most platforms, I really started moving away from consoles after like the generation of like PlayStation 3 because it got so gross to me. I started seeing a really bad trend for console gaming, and I started getting more heavily in, you know, like I've always played all platforms, but I started really, really getting to where it was like mostly what I did was PC. And I was excited to see The Last of Us come to PC, and Naughty Dog did a bad job. So The Last of Us Part 1 came to PC. They did not port the game themselves. Unfortunately, I actually talked about this yesterday. Naughty Dog let Iron Galaxy port the game for them. They published it, they released it, and the game was a hot piece of garbage on PC. And for that reason, I haven't played it on PC. So, feels bad. But I was pretty interested in playing it until that happened. So, I don't know. Fable 4's narrative lead is leaving Playground Games. Yikers, dude. I wonder how far into the development of that game they are right now and how much work was left on it for this this individual. That's rough, dude. We'll take a look. But I do know, I mean, The Last of Us is supposed to be a banger of a series, man. You know, it's supposed to, I mean, it's renowned for a reason. It's very, supposed to be very, very, very good, and I would love to play it. I think that they've made strides. I know that Naughty Dog at least had come out and said, look, we screwed up. We're trying to make the game right and everything. And so, I mean, kudos on them, but it should have never happened. You know? The way it came off to me was that they tabbed Iron Galaxy, who has had other bad PC ports in their history. They tabbed Iron Galaxy to do their PC port. Iron Galaxy said, hey, it's ready. Naughty Dog said, hey, cool, publish it. And they didn't do their due diligence in testing the game before it got published. And when it got released, it was a hot, broken mess. You know, and that's just not acceptable, man. Enjoyed watching him. Yeah. Yeah. I've seen a little bit, but I always wanted to play him, so I didn't watch very much at all, you know? I didn't want to be spoiled on it. Yeah. Red Dead Redemption Remaster could be hitting us before too long. Again, it got re-rated in Korea, which usually is an indicator that there's a remaster or a remake coming. A remaster is probably a pretty good bet there for Red Dead Redemption, but we don't have anything official yet. We'll find something out soon enough, I'm sure. Yeah, we saw this, dude. Xbox is incorporating... Yeah, let's bring this up. We'll talk about this again today. I think this is great. I want to know exactly what they're planning on, because they're going to be... terms, right? Like, what can and can't you... like, can you just troll people out without, you know, like competitive banter, trolling people out a little bit without getting into like toxic talk? Discriminatory hate speech, that kind of thing. Can you know if you're not engaging in that kind of stuff, are you going to be okay? Or is anything at all just going to be like, oh, you're getting banned? You know, that's what we need to know, because you know, you guys know how I feel. I don't think there's anything wrong with competitive banter in video games. It's been there all along, but it's very easy for that to, you know, tip over into the really bad hate speech and discriminating. You know, there are a lot of people that just can't stand it. If they start getting trolled out, they lose their minds and they start spewing filth, man, toxicity and stuff. And it's one of those things, a lot of developers are just like, we're not going to let any of it happen because they know how easy it can flow from one side to the other, you know? So we'll take another peek at this today and see if there are any more details. We talked about this. We've talked about this. Huh. Astrolabe Games hosted a presentation at Bit Summit Let's Go in Kyoto, showcasing its upcoming lineup of charming indie games. Let's take a peek at this. We love indie devs, man. Major Nelson leaving Microsoft. So that's why. So there's an official Assassin's Creed Mirage haptic gaming suit on the way. That's what it is. It's an actual haptic suit. Interesting. Let's take a look at that. It'll only cost you $10,000. And a kidney. Oh, it looks like Sony's new accessibility controller they've been working on is going to be getting set for pre-orders soon. Interesting. Take a quick peek at that. We've seen that that's been in development for a while. God dang, dude. Payday 3 fans furious as game set to be always online. Yeah. I mean, consider me not surprised. This is where everything is going, man. I mean, let's take a look. Look, this is a heavily multiplayer focused game, but you can play this game solo. You can play this game solo. I'll say this. Payday 2, playing the game solo with AI controlled teammates was infuriating. The AI was stupid. It was terrible. It was so much harder to get things done the way you wanted to get things done than just having human players on your team. But it is a game that's promoted as a solo experience as well as multiplayer. So, you know, if that's the way they're going to promote it, then I can see why people would be upset if the game is you know, you can only play online, right? Goes back to those DRM conversations that we have all the time as well. StarCraft 3 is reportedly in development. Come again? What? Hello? It only took how long? What? I mean, to be fair, that game's been popular forever. It still makes tons of money, so. But a new iteration will be just an absolute banger, dude, as long as they do a good job with it. Three games leaving Game Pass today. I'll touch on that real quick for everybody. Inch 1440p gaming monitor, $270. We'll take a look for anybody that needs a monitor. I'll be honest. I'm like, you know, with what happened to me yesterday, I'm like, hey, dude, that looks pretty nice. Yo, randomote time. How good does it feel to have the randomote fixed, man? Jeez. Oh, troll. That's probably a nice indicator as to how today will go.
Unacceptable!
Nice, Kayla.
No.
Ah, wow. The FTC got denied for their, like, basically, like, their request for a retrial on this. Interesting, man. I wasn't necessarily expecting that. Yo, thanks, Poison. Steam users can now play new EA game for free. We'll take a peek. Look, man, I am not big about promoting EA games at all. I despise that company so much. But their reach is so far and wide. The umbrella is so huge. And, I mean, it's free software, apparently. So if it's free, then I'll let you guys know, okay? Yo, there's Dave the Diver. Viral sushi making game. That game is so good, guys. And we're gonna get back to it too. I just wanted to try out some Exoprimal for the weekend. .343 responds to rumors that Halo is in trouble. Let's look at that. We've known that 343, I mean, Microsoft even told 343 that they're basically being pulled off of Halo as the primary developer anyways at the beginning of this year. We didn't know who got tabbed to take it over, but yo, that teenager who leaked all the who hacked Rockstar and leaked all the GTA 6 stuff has been deemed unfit to stand trial. What? I'm going to have to turn that off. Yo, one second. Where is that? I was messing around with a setting. That's why that noise is coming up. Now I can't remember where the heck that setting is, dude. I'll find it. I'll have to do it later. All right. Concept of digital only video game releases is more daunting than you think. PC's been there forever. Already. I mean, we've been there for quite a while anyways. Forever was a bit of an over-exaggeration, but PC's been there for a long time. It's the other platforms that are basically having to play catch-up now. I know it doesn't feel good to a lot of people. I still maintain a physical collection on a specific platform. It's part of its nostalgia, part of its collectors, want that physical copy. Part of its people that need physical copies because they don't have internet or good internet, you know? And if the console developers don't get their crap together and figure out how to move forward, Nintendo's in a better position than like Xbox and PlayStation are, but they've got to quit using optical media. It's not big enough anymore. I'm surprised they continued to use it for this generation of console, but you know, if they don't move forward with something new with their next gen, most stuff is just going to go digital. The games are too big. And developers don't want to be pushing out multiple discs anymore. They just don't want to do it. That's why you see things. This is Alan Wake 2 right here. Alan Wake 2 has already come out and been like, yo, it's digital only for us. Digital only. You know, we've seen a lot of stuff like this here recently. Just because developers and publishers don't want to deal with it. If these games are that big that they can't fit on one disc, they're like, we're not doing a physical copy, you know. And it's really, it's not these developers, the developers of these games and publishers of these games, it's not their fault. It's the developers of the consoles. It's their fault. They created this issue. So what sucks is that like the developers of these games and publishers of these games that are going, yo, it's only going to be digital for us. They're catching a bunch of criticism right now from like the gaming community. Like, why, you know, rah, 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 why are you only doing digital copies? And it's not their fault. Games are getting too big. And, you know, you cannot blame the developer for not wanting to push out two or three discs. I mean, we're well beyond that point of, you know, software publishing and boxing anymore. We shouldn't have to be doing that. There are plenty of other mediums that can be used that can hold all the data that needs to be for physical copies of games. But it's the developer's fault for not incorporating a new method on their platforms. Not these developers. It's not the developers of the software themselves, right? It's not their fault. Because it keeps coming up, I'm just going to say this. Most of you know how I feel. I'm glad that CDPR stuck by Cyberpunk and turned it into something decent. That game should have never been released the way it did. And in my opinion, the very least they could have done was pushed out Phantom Liberty as extra content for the game to say, we're sorry. We're sorry for baiting so many people into buying a game that wasn't ready. And we're sorry for releasing it, even though we knew it was ready. We're sorry for publishing a terrible, terrible product, a broken product. And hopefully, you know, this would show people that we're trying to do better. But that's not what they're doing. They're publishing Phantom Liberty and they're making people pay for it. And in my opinion, there's a lot of things that CDPR does that just kind of gross to me. And I'm glad they stuck by it. I'm glad a lot of people have gotten to a point where Cyberpunk is an enjoyable experience for them. But in my opinion, no game should release like that. And from the history of what I've seen from CDPR, this is just a basically a product of them trying to get away with things that they've done in the past as well. And so I could give a crap less of them getting to a very positive point on Cyberpunk reviews on Steam. They made so much flipping money off people. What was it? 13 million copies they sold? Take this into consideration. Altogether, with pre-orders and retail, pre-orders and games, copies they sold on release of Cyberpunk 2077, it was roughly 13 million copies. 13 million copies at $60 a pop, or maybe I did $50 a pop, something. It was almost almost 8 million, something like that, which was well over double what they put into the game. And most people got cheated. Very few people could actually play the game on release. It's terrible. Should never happen. And again, I'm glad they stuck by it. I'm glad they turned it into something decent. Shouldn't have ever released when it did. I think they're talking about Exo Primal here. Look, I'm going to play Exo Primal again today. We'll play it together. And yesterday I was pretty unenamored with the game. I mean, it's polished. Feels good, but it's very shallow. There's not much you can do. And for that, it feels really bad. This is a $60 game unless you're playing on a subscription service, which I highly recommend. If you're interested in Exo Primal, play it on subscription service before you decide to dump $60, $70 into this game. And it's so heavily saturated with like transactions, real money transactions, that you would expect to see in something like a free-to-play game. This is, in my opinion, right now, in my experience with Exo Primal, it's a bad look from Capcom, dude. Excuse me. Yeah, this is Naraka Blade Point. We talked about this yesterday. It's on PS5 now. It's free-to-play. It's like a melee, third person melee shooting, or I guess not necessarily shooting, but ranged attack, melee focused with abilities and stuff, kind of battle royale type game, right? But it is free to play now. Harry Potter. Wait, Hogwarts Legacy, did they finally get their Nintendo release date? Is this for reals? Yeah, it does have a date. Okay. It does have a date. Yeah, we'll look at it. Look, I think anybody that already is just has played a game and goes, game of the year's done. I would not respect their opinion in any kind of capacity for game of the year awards ever, because we're only halfway through the year. And for them to go, I mean, and I'm not talking about people going, this is my game of the year right now, right? But for somebody to play a game and go, this is game of the year, nothing will beat it. And for them to just blatantly disregard any other game to be played for the rest of the year and not even consider any other piece of software, gaming software, as a potential game of the year candidate is, that's a very short-sighted take. I've got a couple on my radar right now for game of the year, but I say this all the time. There's still half a year left. There's a lot of software still to come out, a lot of games still left to play, and you have to keep an open mind about that. Everybody's going to have a different opinion on these kinds of things, right? Some you'll agree with, some you will not, and that's okay, but you have to keep an open mind about the fact there's still a lot of software to be released this year, a lot of games to be released, and you have to be open to the fact that there's still going to be good games coming to us, right? We talked about that already. Let's dive in here. Let's do this. Oh, starting off with 3-4-3. All right, let me preface this real quick with some info that we got. Earlier in the year, you know, Microsoft did a lot of layoffs and throughout their gaming division as well. 343 is a Microsoft developer, and 343 got hit with layoffs. And at the same time, Microsoft and Xbox went to 343 and said, hey, guess what? From what we heard, anyways, out of this situation, was that 343 got told by Microsoft and Xbox that they are no longer going to be the lead developers on Halo moving forward. Now, we didn't hear anything about who was going to be taking over, but what we did hear was that they're not going to be taken off completely, but they would just be maintaining more of like an advisory type of role in Halo's development moving forward, but not really do too much in touching the game. Just kind of like a parent role, if you will, to try and keep them on track and stuff for whoever was going to be taking over. Breaking Halo news has been trending on Twitter today following a rumor claiming Xbox was potentially putting the series on ice. The rumor came the way of a Twitter user by the name of Haley Era, a source with no track record in the business of scoops, but with a few thousand followers. It's perhaps the latter that is responsible for the rumor garnering some attention. If you missed the rumor, it claimed that Halo was no longer considered a flagship series by Xbox as of a few months ago. To this end, it was claimed that the next Halo game will be the final Halo game if it does not meet expectations. The rumor added said Halo game will have half the budget of Halo Infinite. There was much more than this, but these were the main points of the scuttlebutt. What a great word, scuttlebutt. At the time of its posting, many were skeptical of the rumor for the aforementioned reasons. This isn't the first rumor to paint a gloom and doom picture of 343 Industries and the future of Halo. It likely won't be the last. However, Halo fans can seemingly rest assured there's nothing to this latest claim. Taking to Twitter, John Junisic, a senior community manager at 343, referenced the rumor and essentially chalked it up to nothing more than a conspiracy. Quote this with breaking Halo news and following it up with wild declarations. Let's see who's got the best theories and conspiracies. To be fair, there's been plenty of instances of rumors being denied by developers and publishers only for said rumors to end up being true, or at least partially true. Yeah, no doubt. However, there's no reason to expect this is an example of that. Not only does the source have no track record, but the claims themselves raise many red flags. The rumor may be completely false. There's no denying that Halo series has seen better days. It's not as prominent of a series for Xbox or the industry as it used to be. And it's unclear how big its future is under 343, which so far has failed to replicate the success of the series' golden era under Bungie. Yep. Yeah. So, I don't think that what we had read earlier was official news either, so I don't know how much, stock you can put into the fact that 343 isn't going to be the main developer moving forward with Halo, but there were a lot of reports coming out that was kind of what had taken place, but I don't think it was anything officially announced, so as far as what I prefaced this with, as well as what's being read here, we'll just have to wait and see what happens, But, I mean, it's not. I don't think it's going to be lost on anybody that Halo hasn't been anything close to what it was in the past, Teenager who allegedly leaked the GTA 6 deemed, leaked all the GTA 6 stuff from the hacks, deemed unfit to stand trial. Alleged hacker that leaked the GTA 6 footage was evaluated by psychologists prior to a criminal trial. What? He's been deemed unfit to stand trial. Rockstar Games is a notoriously secretive company that keeps its games well under wraps, even up until release. Very little actually seems to leak out, and when it does, very few people actually believe it until the game has already been released. With that said, last September, Rockstar Games was hacked, and over an hour's worth of footage from GTA 6 was leaked online. This was our first look at GTA 6, a game Rockstar had confirmed was in the works but didn't give any details on. Fans were able to deduce that the game had two protagonists, including the series' first female one, and is set in Vice City. Naturally, despite the fact the game was clearly unfinished, fans were ecstatic to be able to get a look at a game they've waited a decade for and quickly picked the footage apart for any nugget of information they could salvage. Look, I'll stand by this. This is a terrible thing. Quite often, we talk about how much we want as gaming enthusiasts, we want the developers that we enjoy to take our feedback into consideration, be open and communicate with us and have a good relationship with us as their community. And this type of thing destroys those relationships, makes it to where these developers no longer want to have anything to do with us as a community of gamers, no matter what, because it's not worth it to them. The fact of the matter is that when a developer is ready to show us information on something they're developing, they'll give it to us. But it's so unfortunate that they're always on edge about things like this having to happen. Leaks happening, and don't get me wrong, there are going to be times where developers will, unofficially leak information to kind of build up the hype train and stuff, but this, I guarantee you, was not part of that. And, there are so many people that just can't chill out and wait for the developer to bring the information to us, as opposed to just resorting to some kind of, doing something like this and getting their hands on information and then leaking it out to the entire world, and it's not good, dude. Don't get me wrong. There have been things that have happened on the side of developers as well that have harmed the relationship between us also. But for things to get better and move forward, we've got to get away from doing these kinds of things to each other. They need to quit releasing terrible games. That's one of the things we get baited on all the time as consumers and video game enthusiasts that harms the relationship on the constant. It's terrible. It sucks. That harms things. And then things like that happen on this front, it is terrible. And it's the other way around. It makes developers not want to have anything to do with us, but we always want to provide feedback and we have ideas about what we'd like to see in a game that we feel like could make it better and stuff like that. And they're so reluctant anymore, it feels like, to have open lines of communication back and forth with us because they're so worried about things like this happening, you know? Didn't take long for the law to catch up to those that they suspected were behind the hack, but things went quiet last fall. That said, we have a new update on the story. As reported by Reuters, 18-year-old Arian Kurtaj has been accused by London prosecutors of hacking Rockstar Games and a number of other companies, including Uber. He was 17 at the time, I think. This was allegedly done in conjunction with a hacking group known as Lapsus, but Kurtaj will not stand trial. Psychiatrists assessed the 18-year-old and deemed him unfit to stand trial. So the jury will have to determine whether he carried out the acts he's been accused of, rather than determining a guilty or non-guilty verdict.
What?
How has he been deemed unfit to stand trial? Kurtaj has been charged with 12 offenses, including 3 counts of blackmail, 2 counts of fraud, 6 charges under the Computer Misuse Act. Rockstar has not... So, jury has to determine whether he carried out the acts he's been accused of rather than determining a guilty or non-guilty verdict. Rockstar has not issued any statements about GTA 6 since this hack. The leaks are not expected to disrupt development in any significant way. Fans are hoping the new Grand Theft Auto will be properly announced later this year. Yeah, there's a lot of speculation as to when this will hit, but it's a big, big game, dude. I would like to know why. That was my big, big wonder here was like, why was he deemed unfit to stand trial? You know, but that might be like information that won't be public or whatever, you know? Well, you have to understand what's going on here, dude. So... Not only, so if you didn't hear the rest of this, right? So it wasn't just Rockstar that he hacked. These are businesses, man. And what's going on here? You're talking about a game in GTA 6 that reportedly has a budget for development that's over $1 billion, bro. Right? So, not only Rockstar, though, this is apparently an individual that had hacked other companies as well, like Uber and places like that, right? And there are laws in place against doing this kind of thing because it's harmful to businesses. Right? It's against the law. And so, and let's just talk particularly about Rockstar and GTA 6. So, the fact of the matter is, he basically infiltrated their network unlawfully. He stole a bunch of information that wasn't supposed to be public, leaked it all out, and that's basically... grounds for them to go after him and say that he has... And dude, there was code. A ton of code behind the game. Right? So a ton of the actual written code behind the game was stolen by him and leaked online. Which means that other developers can take that and reverse engineer it and use it and stuff like that. That is severely, severely detrimental to Rockstar's business, right? So that's why this is a big deal. Not only did he break a bunch of laws in doing this kind of thing, but he's like ruining a bunch of stuff for a business potentially. And it wasn't just Rockstar. There were other businesses too. So that's what you have to understand about the gravity of this situation. Excuse me. Hogwarts Legacy, is it on Switch? So basically, no, it's not. Not yet. But apparently we've got a date here. All this other stuff I've already kind of looked at. It's, this is what you need to know. The gist of this is like, they're planning on Hogwarts Legacy being on, hitting Switch to, on Tuesday, the 14th of November, okay? But basically, they're having to like completely, which is the way this should go anyways. This is why this game felt bad on PC, was because they didn't make the game for PC. They made the game for console. They ported it to PC. It was a bad port and it felt terrible. So what basically what this says is they're having to take the game and build it up specifically for the Switch. Like they should. Because the Switch is just hardware-wise much older and not nearly as powerful as the other platforms that this game is going to be on. It's going to look different. It's going to feel a little bit different. You're not going to get the same kind of frames. It's not going to look nearly as nice, but it'll be there from what they're saying. So expect that, right? It'll probably be locked at 30 frames. It won't look that good. Go take a look at like Witcher 3 on like any other platform, and there are comparisons out there for any other platform as well as to like what it looks like on the Switch. That'll give you kind of an idea of what Hogwarts Legacy will look like on the Switch compared to other ones, you know. Okay, so I mean, I've talked a lot about, so I'll just finish this up. So that's what I would say. 14 November for Hogwarts Legacy for the Switch, right? That's when to expect it. That doesn't mean it won't get delayed or anything. We'll see what happens. Hopefully it'll feel good. Hopefully it'll feel better than it did on PC. You know what I mean? So this is what I'll say, Davey. There are, right and wrong ways to go about stuff, right? I mean, I'm sure you've heard the term, two wrongs don't make a right. Yeah. And, so to be fair, you're not talking about somebody taking on EA. Or somebody taking on, you know, like, it's like, Rockstar, to be fair, dude, Rockstar does a pretty good job with their games. So, for that point there, where you brought that on, I mean, I'm not necessarily going to side with that. I understand where you're coming from. I mean, I bring that point up a lot, where we've felt cheated, we've felt, you know, baited into buying broken titles all the time. It's a plague on the industry right now, right? But and that's where, I mean, dude, I've said a lot where we need more regulations on the industry. It shouldn't be acceptable and it shouldn't be allowed for these companies to get away with doing that kind of stuff to us, right? But that doesn't give somebody the right to just go break laws that are in place to do that kind of thing either. Yeah. And so what we need to do is try to be progressive about the situation, try to raise awareness about the fact that the gaming industry has issues where we need to start trying to prompt for getting these kinds of regulations put in place so that if something like this does happen moving forward, you know what I mean? It can be taken care of the right way rather than people taking it upon themselves to like break a bunch of laws and do scummy things like this to maybe companies that don't deserve it. You know what I mean? So I'm not necessarily disagreeing with it. You know how I feel about that, right? I mean, dude, I hate it. I hate the crap we deal with in this industry right now, man. It drives me insane. You know, I rant about it all the time, but, I think it's just, you know, like I said, it's more about us trying to find appropriate, proper ways to deal with the scummy businesses that do it. And Rockstar, honestly, I mean, I don't think that, you know, I can't think of anything off the top of my head that they'd really done anything to deserve that, really, you know. But a lot of people look at, like, the AAA side, the big business side of the gaming industry just as one big mess, you know. So I don't know, it's hard, it's a hard thing to address, you know. All right, what up, Wick? You dog faced me, dude. Did it work? I wasn't even paying attention. So speaking of the scummy AAA side of things, I don't necessarily want to be promoting an EA game, but you know, you can play a new EA game for free on Steam, apparently. New EA game released last month is free to download and play, but the window for the latter is limited. More specifically, it's limited to the end of the weekend. In other words, for two more days, you can check out the game. Obviously, there's a limited window, but it's ample enough time to get a taste of the game and find out if you want to buy it outright. Normally, it costs $40, but until July 20th, it's on sale for $35. The game in question comes the way of developer Metalhead Software. It's Super Mega Baseball 4, and it's published by EA. Came out on June 2nd, boasts a mostly positive Steam user review rating with 70% review rating the game positively. Meanwhile, it's been verified for Steam Deck. Should be minimal issues running the game on the Valve handheld machine. This is the game. Take a look. Big Poppy, dude. Bigger Poppy? That dude is thick. Yeah, dude, you see that cake? Oh, God, dude, what? That looks pretty funny, actually. They got Babe Ruth. Nice. A rat, dude.
Legends say they're still trying to get to that ball.
There you go. Super Mega Baseball 4. If you guys are interested, I'll link it. They'll have links in there so you can check it out. Dude is thick, bro. Wig, did you get to play Exo Primal yet? FTC loses final attempt to block the Microsoft Activision acquisition, guys. So FTC lost its final attempt at blocking the acquisition of Activision Blizzard by Microsoft. So, FTC moved to block the deal via a lawsuit at the end of last year. A hearing that concluded in June ruled in favor of Microsoft. But the FTC made one last Hail Mary attempt to try and block the deal via an appeal on the verdict. However, the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals has denied the FTC's request, and now Microsoft will be able to close the deal after tonight at midnight. It's unlikely this will happen this weekend, But it could happen next week. However, there's some pretty complicated matters happening in the UK. Yeah, okay, we already knew that. Microsoft can close the deal in the US, but the UK may complicate things. Yeah, they're trying to figure this out right now. We already kind of knew this. Look, they're talking about maybe selling off some of their cloud business stuff over in the UK to appease the UK regulatory committee. They're trying to figure out a way to go ahead and get this taken care of. You know, that's the last real hurdle for them. But this is about to be done. It's about to be done. Thank God. I mean, I really thought it would be, this is the way it would go the whole time. But they've had some significant hurdles. And honestly, I'm just ready for it to be finished. I just hope Microsoft does the right thing here and gets rid of Bobby Kotick. Honestly, I just want to see Microsoft do decent with, you know, the acquisition. I want to see them get Blizzard, Activision, you know, especially Blizzard, back into something that I can respect again, dude. You know, but it'll be nice to have this over with, man. You were at work late. Didn't get home till 11:30. Jesus, dude. What'd you do? Spill smoothies everywhere, bro? A team behind PlayStation finds PlayStation's Patapon reveals successor game Ratatan. Ratatan is being developed for unspecified platforms by Patapon creator Hiroyuki Kitani, with audio by original Patapon musician Kimi Adachi. The game will be crowdfunded via Kickstarter with campaign due to start on July 31st. Originally released for the PSP handheld in 2007, Patapon is a rhythm-based 2D platform action game in which players command an army of cute anthropomorphic eyeballs known as Patapons that can be commanded to move forward, attack, defend, and retreat by using a sequence of drum beats. Game received two sequels on PSP. The first two games were remastered with 4K visuals on PlayStation 4. Few details on Ratatan were revealed during its Bit Summit panel. The game's developers told VGC in a private meeting ahead of the reveal the game would include roguelike elements and multiplayer for up to four players. So this is going to be their new one. All right, there you go. So the Kickstarter kicks off again on July 31st. So that's about all we really know right now for this. Okay, stick, dude. Yeah. Yeah. I'm like kids pop. Let's go, dude. Let's get it. Classic Call of Duty games being revived by hundreds of thousands of players on Xbox. I wonder why. A bunch of old Call of Duty games are having a resurgence on Xbox right now. The Call of Duty series is one of the most tried and true online franchises in gaming. Every holiday season for the last 20 years, a new Call of Duty has been released. A ton of different types of games in the series have made their mark, with different groups of players having their preferences on their favorite eras of Call of Duty. Some prefer the World War II games, some prefer the modern era of games, some prefer the futuristic games, despite the fact that it's a series that has a pretty familiar formula. Activision has done a good job of making sure there's enough variety. Duty on Xbox 360. My bad. Duty. However, a lot of people's favorite entries have been virtually unplayable for a while. Almost every Call of Duty on Xbox 360 was made backwards compatible for Xbox One, and subsequently Xbox Series X, but after a short while, the multiplayer for these games became basically unplayable as the servers didn't function properly. Activision fixed these games earlier this week, and now players are returning to them en masse. Call of Duty Modern Warfare 3, a game from 2011, has nearly 70,000 active players on Xbox. Call of Duty Black Ops has over 100,000. These player counts are more than what Call of Duty Modern Warfare 2 from last year has on Steam right now, meaning tons of players are returning and reviving these once-dead games. On top of that, Xbox has also put the Call of Duty franchise on sale, so you can get many of these older games for about $10 to $15. Unclear exactly what was preventing these games from being fixed previously. Seems like there's been a lot of demand for this to happen. Now players are actively playing these games. With that said, it's likely that has something to do with the Activision deal being allowed to go through in the U.S., despite the fact that it hasn't closed quite yet. Yeah, that's what I kind of figured. Yep. So there you go, guys. If you've been waiting to get down on some Xbox Call of Duty stuff, some of the old games, they're popping off right now. They probably have some links to the cells and everything in there, too. I didn't pay close enough attention, but if you need it. Okay, man, here we go. So, this is one of those games where I'm a bit hesitant, a bit hesitant about what to expect from this title, Fable 4. Just initially, you know, I know a lot of people were super psyched just to see the trailer, you know, and for me it was like, okay, cool, but until I actually see some legitimate, like, gameplay, in-depth gameplay and stuff, I'm not going to get too hyped about this as much as, I mean, I still own original Fable. You know, I loved the Fable games. They were great. We're talking about a developer, though, in Playground Games that has never really done anything of note outside of the Forza stuff, right? Forza Horizon stuff. And look, that doesn't mean this game's going to be bad. Don't get me wrong. I want developers to be able to shine and show that they can do things outside of their norm. I think it's a big risk throwing a game like Fable, which is very, very iconic and that people have been waiting for a number of years now to be revamped, and to throw it to a developer that we only know them for doing auto racing games, you know? And again, it doesn't mean that it's going to be bad, but I think that people need to maybe hinder those expectations a little bit as to what Fable 4 will end up being like. And I hope it's great. I hope it's very good, because Fable is something that people have always loved. And I would love for it to be very good. But it looks like their narrative lead is leaving Playground Games. So after over 3 years of working with the UK studio, Fable 4 narrative lead Anna McGill announces her departure from Playground Games. Just a little over a month after the long-awaited title made its world debut, Playground Games Fable 4 is losing one of its key team members with the departure of narrative lead Anna McGill. In addition to its work on Fable 4, Playground is also responsible for the wildly successful Forza Horizon series of racing games on PC and Xbox consoles. If you're not familiar, Fable franchise offers players an often comedic take on the typical fantasy RPG. Set in the fictional realm of Albion, each Fable game takes place in a different time period and tasks players with traditional action RPG gameplay, infused with a heavy dose of player choice. How players choose to develop their character, how they treat others in Albion, will influence their appearance, abilities, and even the world around them in some instances. They called that a gameplay trailer, dude, but I don't know how much of that was actually gameplay. It feels like the same thing that we saw out of Hellblade, which was weird also, because the Hellblade 2 trailer, they were calling that gameplay, when really all it looked like was like you walking into a cave and then going into a cinematic. So I don't know how much I believe that Fable 4 trailer was actual gameplay. There might have been a little bit of it. I remember just a little bit of it looking like gameplay, but a lot of it looked like cinematic to me. Now, it feels like a lot of developers are getting away nowadays just being able to incorporate small amounts of gameplay in a trailer that's mostly cinematic and calling it a gameplay trailer. I don't agree with that. And I could be wrong there, but I mean, that's the way it's starting to feel to me. As first reported by GamesRadar, Fable 4 narrative lead Anna McGill has announced her departure from developer Playground Games after over 3 years with the company. McGill, who had previously worked as both the lead writer on Ubisoft's The Division 2 and the narrative lead for Remedy Entertainment's Control, announced her departure from the UK-based studio on her personal Twitter account, stating that she had a busy year between working on Fable 4 and writing two books. McGill said she would be taking some time off following her resignation. Despite moving on from the studio, McGill appeared to hold no ill will towards Playground Games, remarking in a tweet that working on Fable was a dream come true for me and it's wrenching to leave it behind. Although a high-level shakeup like this might leave some gamers feeling worried about the future of the franchise's latest entry, McGill assured Fable 4 fans that, well, yeah, this is the default statement when something like this happens, right? So you expect this. Playground has assembled a heroically talented team, so I know it's in good hands. Jesus. Well, this is stupid, but I'll... So even with the excitement surrounding the return of the long-running franchise, the debut of Fable 4 didn't land with every fan. In a sadly now all too common occurrence in the gaming industry, the Fable 4 trailer was flooded with dislikes by viewers upset both by the choice of a female protagonist and the fact that they didn't consider her attractive enough. Jesus, are you kidding me, dude? The world we live in, bro, is so insane. Bunch of flipping incels, dude. God dang. Like, don't get me wrong. I mean, you know, Fable has traditionally had a male main character and everything, but can you just quit? Just shut up. Who cares? It was never a big deal, right? Before, like, it was a male character, but it wasn't a big deal if it was a male character, right? The stereotypical, like, main protagonist in video games, you know? So that was never supposed to be an issue. And now when things change, because whether it be, you know, a character gets... And I know a lot of people be like, well, it's, you know, they're changing the main character, but it's been a long time since we've had a Fable game, man. They're switching stuff up. Just get wrecked, dude. Can you find something else to, like... It's like, this is where people throw, like, of all the things in the world to throw a fit about, you know what I mean? This is where people start getting their undies in a bunch, you know? Jesus Christ. Grow up, dude. Even though fans of the franchise have already been waiting for the next entry for years at this point, Fable 4 seems to be off to a bumpy start. But despite some pushback from disgruntled gamers and the departure of McGill, hopefully Playground Games will be able to deliver a worthy successor to the series whenever Fable 4 is eventually released. Yeah. So, I don't know. You know, obviously her quote there was the default. Anytime something like this happens, you know, they push out a default statement. It's like, don't worry, you're in good hands. Everything will be okay. You know, but I think there was already reason to be a bit hesitant about this game just based off of what I said before. And we'll just have to see what happens. I hope it's great, dude. I really do. I hope it's great. I have no concerns whatsoever about the game having a lead female protagonist or antagonist, depending on how you play the game. Mine will probably be an antagonist. I just find it crazy that people have such an issue with that kind of thing. I guess one of the things that you could say is that today's day and age with gaming, and the best thing that a developer can usually do is give people choices. You know, when it comes to playing a character, give people choices. People want immersion. The role play in role playing games, they want that immersion. A lot of times people want to feel a connection. To avoid a lot of that criticism. To me, it doesn't matter. I don't care really, you know. Xbox comes after toxic gamers with recorded voice chats. Yeah, we talked about this yesterday a little bit. A new feature is coming to Xbox One Series S and X consoles that aims to tackle toxicity in voice chats. If you're not hearing someone's music or TV blaring through voice chat, there's a good chance, Jesus, how much does that suck, dude? I can't stand that. If you're not hearing someone's music or TV blaring through voice chat, there's a good chance you're hearing someone insult your mother. Yeah, dude. Yeah. Dude, that's the worst though. Like one of my most hated things about voice chat is this, and it's often, quite often, it's music. you'll hear people just blaring their music into your headset. And it's like, could you just shut up? Like, what? I don't even care if it's the kind of music I like. Like, if I wanted to listen to it, I would turn it on myself and not make everybody else listen to it. Just shut up. You're not cool, man. And, or they sound like they're sucking on their flipping microphone, dude. Like mouth breathers. You know what I mean? You got mouth breathers sitting there with their headset and the microphone, and it's like stuck inside their mouth, and they're like, it's like, God dang, dude, give me a break. But yeah, the insult your mother thing, that's a good one. Toxicity in online gaming is well documented, no secret. That said, Xbox is targeting inappropriate verbal behavior with a new feature that will allow Xbox gamers to voice record other users and report the contents of this recording to Xbox itself. Players come to Xbox to build friendships, be competitive, and to experience incredible games. Here's the thing. I truly feel that this be competitive, what goes along with be competitive is competitive banter. Now, there is a point where it falls into an area that's not acceptable, right? When you talk about discriminatory hate speech, people prompting self-harm, those kinds of things are not acceptable. But trolling people out a little bit, having some competitive banter, is part of being competitive, right? They expect to be treated fairly for interactions to be free of hate or harassment, writes Xbox with the new initiative. Our investments in safety have helped players feel safer across text, video, and image. And our new voice reporting experience is the latest addition to our robust suite of family and online safety features. To this end, this week, Xbox is rolling out a platform-wide voice reporting feature to Alpha and Alpha skip-ahead Xbox insiders that will allow players to the option to capture and report inappropriate in-game voice chats. What exactly classifies as inappropriate, Xbox doesn't outline. That's what I was looking for. Yo, what's up with my chat? Yo, are we good? My chat just disconnected and reconnected. Is everybody okay? We all right? Dude, I've dropped a few frames this morning too. Jesus. We all right? Everybody all right? You guys okay? Let me check something real quick. Okay. This is what I was really trying to find out, because again, you know, the way I feel about this entire situation is that there's absolutely unacceptable behavior and engagement, the way people dive into the real toxic speech and communication is not acceptable. But being able to have some competitive banter and troll people out a little bit, you know, I think that's part of competition. How it works is Xbox users will be able to capture a 60-second video clip of an in-game voice incident. From here, the incident will be submitted to the Xbox safety team for review. According to Xbox, the feature is supported and works across 1,000s of games that offer multiplayer voice chat, including Xbox 360 backwards compatible games. Xbox notes that only players can initiate the voice capture feature. Further, Xbox will not be saving or uploading voice clips without you permitting the process. To this end, clips will not appear in your recent captures, nor can they be downloaded, modified, or shared. In fact, after 24 hours passes, Xbox will issue a reminder that the clip can be submitted if it hasn't been. If the user declines at this point to submit the clip, it will be deleted. As for what Xbox will do to users found violating its community standards policy through one of these clips, we don't know. It provides no outline for this either. At the moment of publishing, there's no word of when this feature will roll out to the wider public. Typically, at least several months pass between the alpha stage and the final release of features, but there's no guaranteed timeline. That said, and as always, feel free to leave a comment or two letting us know what you think. Is this the right move by Xbox? Yeah, this is a tough thing to address again. And I think what you're going to see is I don't think a lot of developers are going to disagree with my sentiment about the competitive banter stuff, but you're going to see a lot of them that won't stand for a lot of even the competitive banter that I'm referencing, because it does so easily end up causing people to dive into the deep end of the toxic speech and communication, because there are just a lot of people that can't handle it. You know, there are a lot of people that just lose their minds if they get trolled out a little bit. You get trolled out a little bit, dude, and they just lose their crap and they start going into these tirades of hate speech and prompting self-harm and stuff. And what I think a lot of these developers will start doing is just eliminating all of it. It'll be the whole, if you can't say something nice, don't say anything at all, you know, which kind of sucks. But I think that's where a lot of this is going to end up going. Just because so many people have an issue of just being chill. And just, you know, dealing with a little bit of some banter. Okay, dude. Doomsday Paradise. Astrolabe presents tons of games at Bit Summit. We've got Astrolabe Games hosted a presentation at Bit Summit Let's Go in Kyoto, showcasing its upcoming lineup of charming indie games. Start with the top-down shooter Zombie Soup, developed by Aeon Sparks Interactive, which will release on August 10th for Switch, PS5, PS4, and PC following the early access phase. Zombie Soup. Bullet hell game, yeah. Okay. August 10th. Then we've got Nightmare Escape. Sorry, I was a little bit loud. Okay. July 20th for Switch. Metavoidal, hard rock themed roguelite by Yellow Lab Games. I'm the best drummer. Metavoidal. Zero Division. Robot Cat Games. Cyberpunk themed deck building collectible card game. I'll link this for everybody too at the end, okay? Cool. That looks pretty wild, man. Why does my chat keep disconnecting, dude? What is going on, Twitch? Anatine by Pixel Trash. 2D pixel art Metroidvania game coming for PC and consoles. We'll be right back. can I not flip and find this, dude? Okay. I don't know. More Metroidvania with an adventure game flavor comes with Sophie Starlight Whispers from Youth Gaming.
I have always liked adventures. Now, my king is being attacked by dark creatures. And only I can stop these monsters. I have to believe in myself. And end the evil that haunts us.
Sophie. Alright. Next one is spicy. Doomsday Paradise multiplayer dating sim by Lemonade Flashbang. Here you go.
The apocalypse is here, and it's up to you to save the world.
Nah.
What do you mean, nah?
It just seems like a lot of work.
But all of these hot, eligible singles will die.
Whoa, hold up. You said they're single? Ooh, can I date her?
Heroes can date anyone they want.
Oh, let's go! You should have led with that! What am I doing?
We've seen this before. This is a wild one, dude.
Attacking the town.
Are those cards? Oh, this is an indie game, isn't it?
It's a dating game with...
Oh, God!
Power up and learn new abilities by talking to the townsfolk.
You mean hitting on them? Woo!
Yes, I mean hitting on them. Then, use the skills you've learned to keep the town safe from annihilation.
Hold on a sec, why is there four people? Is this multiplayer?
It's a four-player game. Team up or sabotage your friends while building a shared narrative.
You mean they might try to
when
stop
did we see this initially? I can't even remember now.
They're on your side.
I won't let them!
Been a little
I'll
while.
Take them all down first!
Welcome to Doomsday Paradise, the horny party game where you can play with your friends. Battle monsters, get a date, friend pairs. With over 100 endings, you will never run out of ways to make my life miserable. Coming 2023. God help me.
Cool. Dreary by Lobo Saga's studio was shown off. Highly challenging action game supporting a beautiful near monochromatic art style. Coming for PC and consoles to be announced.
Thank you.
Cool. Wait, what is happening, dude? No. No. One second, guys. What is that? Okay, that was kind of weird. Interesting. Beautifully retro visual novel stories from Soul the Gun Dog was also showcased with a presentation directly, directly by the developer. Space Colony Studios provided details on the development roadmap coming for PC in this year. Let's take a look at this. They had a lot. Okay, we're almost at the end of it, though.
Hi, this is Jonathan, the creative director for Stories from Sol, the Gun Dog. It's been great seeing everyone having fun with the demo, and we really appreciate the feedback that we've received from all of you. This input is really important to us as it lets us know how to make the best game possible for you, and has covered things like the writing, the mechanics, and potential improvements. One big focus we'll have as we carry on with development is working much more closely with our translators throughout the script writing process to ensure that regardless of where you're playing Gun Dog and what language it's in, you'll have the same great experience as everyone else. As well as the script, we've heard your requests for improvements in the gameplay. Amongst other quality of life fixes, we've already implemented control support, added hotkeys, and created a history feature for the game's text that can be accessed easily during gameplay. We intend to implement many more improvements to ensure the Gun Dog experience is as polished as you'd expect. Stories from Sol, the Gun Dog, is available to both wishlist and as a demo on Steam. In addition, all players who complete the demo and finish a special survey at the end will receive bonus content in the full release. Check it out to experience the beginning of the Gun Dog today.
Next is Moth Cubit, a cute RPG adventure by Helena Creative Studios, coming to PC in 2023 as well.
Konnichiwa, genki desu ka? Meu nome é Gabriel, eu sou o artista e o programador do jogo Moth Cubit.
Eu sou o Gabs, o diretor e level designer de Moth Cubit. Nós somos um pequeno time de duas pessoas aqui do Brasil. E eu tô aqui pra apresentar o nosso jogo.
Um RPG bizarro e surreal, baseado em diálogo, que se passa em uma mega corporação que tá sugando toda essa energia.
Moth Cubit é inspirado em clássicos e contemporâneos RPGs que desafiam as propostas narrativas, colocando poder na mão do jogador. O nosso protagonista, Moth Cubit, acabou de receber uma promoção da qual ele não estava preparado para assumir. Porém, ele não tem muito o que fazer, porque o processo final não espera por ninguém.
Todos nós sabemos que toda promoção vem com novas responsabilidades. E cabe a você, junto com Moth, resolver puzzles para manter o seu espaço dentro desse trabalho.
Espere encontrar aqueles que foram afetados pelo processo final e esteja preparado para enfrentar aqueles que, assim como você, também querem manipular a realidade.
O processo final é um evento que está resetando a realidade e colocando todo o poder na sua mão, o jogador, para fazer escolhas e ações que vão alterar o mundo ao seu redor. Mas nem tudo deve ser levado de forma tão séria. Trabalhar já é pressão o suficiente. Moth também, às vezes, pode ter um pouco de diversão e se livrar dessa pressão. Não é mesmo, Gabs?
É verdade. Você também pode coletar seus quadrinhos favoritos Lady Glitter. Você pode coletar sementes de flores. Você também pode, tipo, repensar todas as decisões da sua vida e todas as pessoas que você magoou e todas as coisas que você poderia ter feito e não conseguiu e todas as decepções que até agora você acumulou pra dentro de si mesmo. E também você pode...
Eu me arrependo de muita coisa.
Gabs, acorda.
Sim, claro. Você já pode jogar a demo de Moth Cubit e ter a primeira experiência do processo final. E não esqueça de colocar na wishlist.
Bom, infelizmente precisamos voltar ao trabalho. Não é mesmo, Gabs?
Ok. And last but certainly not least, we take another in-depth look at China Hero Project alum Evo Tinction, showcasing the stealth gameplay developed by Spikeweave Games. No release date yet, coming for PlayStation platforms and PC.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the world of Evil Tinction. A stealth game that we're excited to share with you. Meet the Genie, an AI entity that was once a helpful assistant to people, but has now turned rogue. This particular genie is in communication with another, perfect for our virus hack. The virus can spread instantly.
This looks pretty solid, dude. Enemies, Jesus.
Allowing us to disable their movements with a single strategy hack. Now we are inside.
You know what this gives me?
Home.
This gives me a alien isolation vibes, dude.
Here's a geo analyzer. It has an extended range of vision and presents a challenging hacking target. So let's take a different approach. Here's another genie. We will use the turn away ability to manipulate its orientation, keeping it facing away from us and halting its patrol. This gives us a chance to scan the emergency code on its back and shut it down. Over there, we see a signal disruptor. It generates a signal blocking shield that prevents us from hacking enemies within its range. To overcome this, we can use the E-gun to temporarily paralyze it. The paralyzes effect is temporary, so we will implant a motion virus. The signal disruptor isn't communicating with the genies, so spreading the virus will take some time. Alright, now that the virus has spread to the genies, we can activate it and proceed. By scanning the area, we find another genie hiding behind the wall. We will use the E-gun to disable it. Now we have an opportunity to sneak into the shield. Inside the shield, the signal disruptor can no longer jam our signals. We can now use a sprinkler ahead to neutralize them quickly. There's another geoanalyzer in the distance. We will use the hollow wall to block its line of sight and move forward. That wraps up today's
video.
Wall. We hope you are enjoying this sneak peek of Evolution. See you next time.
Man, that's pretty cool, man. Nice little stealth game, huh? Cool. Alright, man. That's all the look, man. I love indie developers. In my opinion, they need to be promoted much more often in the industry. And I won't always take the time to like dive through all the trailers and stuff we come across in a video gaming news segment, but I wanted to do it today, and promoting indie developers is a big deal to me, so there's the link right there if you guys want more, saw anything interesting out of there, take a look at that, okay? Assassin's Creed Mirage to get official gaming suit that lets you feel parkour and punches. So Ubisoft has partnered with OWO to create a haptic feedback vest that would allow wearers to physically feel the actions of protagonist Basim as he parkours and fights his way through 9th century Baghdad in AC Mirage. By leveraging OWO's groundbreaking technologies and expertise, we're able to immerse players in the world, sounds, and sensations of Assassin's Creed Mirage in an innovative and enhanced way, said Fabian Solomon, lead producer at Ubisoft Bordeaux. We can't wait for our players to discover and enjoy the coming-of-age story of Basim with the power of OWO. The AC Mirage edition of OWO Haptic Gaming System includes the patented OWO skin, 20 gel pads, an OWO device, and a game code, along with a charging cable and storage pouch. The system is set to be compatible with PC, PS5, and Xbox Series X and S versions of the game. The vest itself has been given a bespoke Mirage aesthetic and is made of a lightweight Lycra augmented with a series of high conductivity electrodes and haptic pads that allow the wearer to feel a variety of sensations across the torso and arms. It's completely wireless, will likely have a battery life of around 8 hours, assuming that its specs are similar to those of the Founders Edition, which is the only other version of the system released to date. Donning the vest will allow players to feel all the impacts and precise parkour movements that protagonist Basim makes and takes as he fights his way through Baghdad. According to OWO, the Mirage edition of the haptic system will incorporate new sensations never felt before by existing users. The sensations can be controlled via the My OWO smartphone app, which allows users to customize their settings modify the intensity of the feedback as needed. No price has been given yet. However, the Founders Edition of the system is currently on sale for 499 euros on OWO's website. So with the addition of the game code, the new offering will more than likely meet that price point or exceed it. There it is. There it is. You guys need links. There you go. I'll give you both for the IGN article and the website to OWO itself. All right. Sony breaks ground in gaming accessibility. Yeah, this is their big accessibility controller they've been working on. We've known this for what, with Project Q or something, I think. Suggested retail price of $90. Sony Interactive Entertainment revealed the pre-orders for its PlayStation Access controller commence on July 21st with a worldwide launch scheduled for December 6th. The blog stated the Access controller will be sold at a suggested retail price of $90 US. Project Leonardo, excuse me, is what it was called. At the Consumer Electronics Show in January, it was unveiled, which aims to develop a customizable PS5 controller to enhance the gaming experience for players with disabilities. It can be used alone or in conjunction with DualSense controllers, allowing collaborative gameplay. Features 3.5mm aux ports for accessibility add-ons and can be positioned flat or mounted. Controller addresses the challenges faced by gamers with limited motor control, similar to Microsoft's Xbox Adaptive Controller released in 2018. Sony's initiative follows Microsoft's leadership in prioritizing accessibility technology in the gaming industry. Yeah, yo, Sekiro, what's up, buddy? How you doing, man? Long time no see, man. I just want to say something real quick. Look, man, I talk about this a lot. As nice as it is that a lot of developers are having more of a focus on accessibility, because everybody should be able to enjoy the world that I love and so many of us love, right? Which is gaming. It sucks that you have to pay even more as a disabled individual for accessibility features to play games. So, you know, what's a DualSense controller? 60, I think, 70 bucks. And if you want to, if you're somebody that has a disability and you need this controller to be able to play games on PlayStation, you're gonna have to pay 20 more bucks for this controller than their just regular DualSense controllers. That sucks, dude. That sucks. Just busy with work, getting hectic. Yo, work. It's good to see you, buddy. You been all right? So, get it, dude. Business is business and everything, but you know, I can't help but think that it just feels bad. They couldn't find a way to at least get the price point of this controller to a point that is on par with normal DualSense 5 controllers, so that people with disabilities that already have such a hard time getting into the gaming world don't have to pay more than anybody else does. You know what I mean? That sucks, dude. That sucks. Hitting fine, that's what I'm talking about, dude. That's good to hear, Sekiro. That's good to hear, buddy. Payday 3 fans furious as game set to be always online. Again, look, I mean, I'm psyched about Payday 3. I loved Payday 2. I played it for a good chunk of time when it first released. or close to its release. And I'm excited for Payday 3. I think it'll be a fun thing for us to play as a community here. And I can understand why some Payday 3 fans will be upset for it being always online, because it is a game that promotes itself as a you can play solo. So these are this game is set in scenarios. It's a scenario-based game where you get into these scenarios with three other players, yourself and three other players. And those three other players can be AI-controlled players. You can play solo. Payday 2 was not a great experience with the AI-controlled players, but it could be done. And that's the way Payday 3 is going to be too. Payday 3 will be as well. And I can see why people would be upset, but I mean, we just get more and more games that are coming out that are doing this, and I think people are just going to have to brace for the fact that we're going to get less and less games that offer offline playability, you know? Offline capability, I guess. While a number of Payday series fans have noted that previous entries in the series have been their go-to, while having internet trouble, it appears Payday 3 will not be the safe haven they were hoping it would be, since should this happen in the future. It recently confirmed that Payday 3 will require players to be constantly online to play the game, and fans are upset. Speaking in a Payday 2 livestream, Star Breeze's global brand director, Almir Listo, confirmed that Payday 3 would require a constant internet connection to be played even solo. Listo said, "You will be able to play by yourself, but I do believe you will have to have a connection in order to play." Cited that because the game is made in the Unreal Engine, it's using cross-progression and cross-play, players would need to be online. Players were notably disappointed by this revelation, with one player on the game's Steam forum saying, "This is the one thing I was very worried about." Another fan on the Payday Reddit page lamented the announcement, saying, "Payday 2 was my go-to when my internet goes out, which is fairly frequent." Some players have gone as far as to suggest canceling pre-orders and no longer wishlisting the game on Steam until the developers remove the feature. User Stealth Cobra said, "If you actually want to try and make a change about the only online feature, then cancel your wishlist pre-order. It's probably the only way OVK Starbreeze will listen to the community. Vote with your wallet." Another player was seemingly put off pre-ordering Payday 3 after the announcement, saying, "I was going to pre-order Payday 3. I've even commented about that before, but now I'm not. I enjoy Payday 2 because of the modding, the offline and solo play." Honestly, again, I mean, I'll read the rest of this. However, some players are still hopeful this won't be a permanent issue with the game, or even that it might be a misunderstanding. Players might take solace in Listo's, I do believe, caveat to the statement, hoping that maybe this still isn't the case. Starbreeze hasn't officially commented on this issue outside of Listo's live stream. I think Payday was a better experience with other players. I really do. But I can understand how it would be off-putting for people. Look, man. In the age that we're in with gaming and all the DRM and, you know, many platforms use it, if you want games to play offline, go get your games on GOG. There are plenty of single-player games out there on GOG that don't require, and GOG is DRM-free. So as long as you've downloaded the game, you've installed the game, you don't need internet connection. So get you a good library built up on GOG, and anytime your internet goes out, you don't have anything to worry about, okay? Payday reminds you of a Jackie Chan movie? Oh, yeah? Just like the name of it? StarCraft 3 is reportedly in development, people. The next game in the acclaimed StarCraft series seems to be on its way, according to journalist Jez Corden. StarCraft 3 is currently in development at Blizzard. In a reply to a fan's question on Twitter about Microsoft reviving StarCraft if and when its purchase of Activision Blizzard closes, which will be very soon, Corden says that won't need to happen. Microsoft won't need to revive StarCraft, Corden says. A different user specifically asked if it was StarCraft 3 and if Corden knew anything about it, and he responded with a simple one-word answer, yep. StarCraft 2, the last game in the series, was originally released 13 years ago in 2010. The game did have a number of expansions, the last of which came in 2016. Since then, however, Blizzard has been quiet on the franchise, focusing on Overwatch and Diablo. With both those series having new releases recently, it would make sense for the company to then turn it to its real-time strategy title. Nothing official, but that's close, as close to about official as you can get. So We'll keep our eyes and ears open for more on the front of StarCraft 3, okay? Reminder, 3 games are leaving Xbox Game Pass as of today, guys. So we've got XO1, Paw Patrol the Movie, Adventure City Calls, and Spelunky 2. These are leaving Xbox Game Pass today, all right? Last article I have, maybe if you're in the market for a monitor, this might be the one for you, okay? I'm going to finish this article up. We're going to move on and play some Exo Primal for the day. If you have anything else to add for video gaming news, let me know in chat and I'll address it before we move on and do our gaming segment for the rest of the day, okay? MSI has a 32-inch 1440p quantum dot gaming monitor at $270 off. So the monitor is $330. It's almost half off right now. So it's at Newegg, and for $330, you'll get an IPS panel, 1 millisecond response time, 175 hertz refresh rate, quantum dot technology to improve the display's color accuracy. It looks like the sale will only last a number of more hours before the price goes back up. Brightness rating of up to 400 nits and at 600 nits of peak brightness with HDR enabled, and it is G-Sync capable. Wide variety of inputs and outputs, including two HDMI 2.0B connectors, one DisplayPort 1.4A connector, and a single Type-C port with display output capabilities. For PS5 owners, the monitor has one trick up its sleeve that allows you to render a 4K output to the display. This way, the console isn't upscaling from 1080p, making the image more detailed. Also, three USB 3.2 Gen 1 Type-A ports and three audio ports for plugging in headsets, peripherals, thumb drives, and anything else that requires a USB or audio connection. All right. Doesn't look like it's a curved monitor. I think that that's probably the one downside to this is that if you're actually sitting in a desk area with a monitor fairly close, I think anything, if you get above 27 inches, you start wanting to get that curve in there. You know what I mean? But it's still a good price, man. I don't know about MSI's warranty or warranty period or what their support is like or anything, but they are a very reputable, I mean, obviously big brand and everything, so you might want to look into that. I can't recommend that enough, looking into not only like the specs of the product you're buying, but the support and warranty, things like that you're buying into with your products too, if you're making any kind of moderate tech purchase, you know. But here you go, it's there in chat, man. I'll actually throw this in Discord as well before I forget. Gamer deals section, it'll be in there. Don't forget about your free games, okay? Free games, Epic. Right now, we've got Train Valley 2 is free until the 20th, and then on the 20th, this will go away, and you'll be able to grab a Murder by Numbers. Also, it looks like The Whisperer is free on GOG. Let me pull up GOG real quick and make sure that we see if this is still free. Pull up GOG. Hold on. There it is. The Whisperer. Look, The Whisperer is free on GOG right now. You've got 47 hours left to grab The Whisperer, okay? Oh, yeah, Sekiro. Right on, man. Right on. Yeah. Get your free games, guys. I can't stress that enough. Free games. Gaming in the huge obstacle that we deal with nowadays and the obstacle of price quite often, you know what I mean? I can't recommend enough you take advantage of the free games. Even if you don't currently a PC gamer, you know, there are a lot of free opportunities for free games all the time on the PC side of things. And who knows if you might become a PC gamer in the future. So go get on your Epic, go get on Epic Games website, create an account, grab their free games every week. Go get on GOG's website, create an account. It's free. Both those sites are free. You know what I mean? And grab your free games. Same thing with Steam. Steam's free. Create an account. When they have free games, grab your free games. That way, if you become a PC gamer in the future, you'll have some different platforms with libraries already built up, you know what I mean, where you can start playing games right away. All it takes is just a little bit of time to go in there, create an account. It's free. Grab your free games, you know. It's easy. It's easy. That is the news, man. That's the news for today. We're going to move on. We're going to go play some Exo Primal, man. Day 2 of Exo Primal. I'm hoping to get more out of it today. It felt very shallow yesterday. Hope that we unlock some more game modes or something, because it feels bleak. Feels bleak. It feels polished, but you know, we talk a lot about, like, if a game has great content but it feels like crap when it's released because it performs poorly, how are you supposed to be able to enjoy that content? And that's something that happens quite often, right? On the flip side of that, if a game feels great, awesome. But if there's no content to enjoy, or you run out of content really, really fast, that's like the opposite problem, right? So, I don't know. We'll dive into Exo Primal again today and see what we get out of it. I'm hoping that as we progress in the story, we'll unlock some new game modes or something, because right now it feels very, very shallow. I mean, it feels polished. It feels well-developed, but it just feels bleak on content, man. So, I don't know. We'll get in there and we'll do that. You guys rock. I appreciate you very much. I hope that your weekend has started well, is going well. Happy flipping Saturday. If anybody is viewing this video gaming news segment now or later as a VOD, we have all previous video gaming news segments, as well as playthroughs of games we've done. Funny, crazy, weird, malding. Clips and highlights of things that have happened here in the channel. All that stuff's on the YouTube and the Twitch channel here and playlists. So go check all that content out. If you're enjoying it, then come hang out with myself, the rest of the amazing people that are part of our community here. Whenever we go live at 6 a.m. CST, 6 days a week, every day but Wednesday. And we always start off with video gaming news before we dive into whatever gaming content we have slated for the rest of the day, okay? Other than that, man, you guys just stay healthy, stay safe, be kind to one another, and we will catch everybody tomorrow for July 16th edition of Video Gaming News. And it'll either be more Exo Primal or more Dave the Diver. All right.